Coming up on Oakdale Update, we'll learn about electric vehicles from an employee of Xcel Energy. And we'll hear about some upcoming events in the city. Stay tuned. Oakdale Update is straight ahead. Hello and welcome to Oakdale Update. I'm your host, Frank Urcello. This is the City of Oakdale's news and information program about your community. You hear about electric vehicles in the news quite a bit these days, so we thought it would be a good idea to learn more. I'm joined today by Kevin Schwain, who is the leader of Xcel Energy's electric vehicle program. Kevin, thanks for joining us on Oakdale Update.
Well, thanks for having me, Frank.
Okay. Give us a little bit, tell us a little bit about yourself.
Sure. I was born and raised here in the Minneapolis-St. Paul area. I live here now with my wife and two kids down by Southdale, actually, mm-hmm. in Edina, Minnesota. I've been an employee of Xcel Energy for a little more than 10 years. Nowadays I'm leading their electric vehicle program, so I'm really excited to tell you more about that here.
Okay. Where'd you go to school? Colleges?
I did a mechanical engineering degree first at Iowa State University down in Ames, and then I did some graduate work at MIT out in Boston, both in engineering and business.
Good deal. So that warms you up for the electric field, is that correct, at all?
I think so, yeah. You need a little bit of technical background and a little bit of business background,
okay.
perhaps.
So what is your role in the Xcel Energy and the electric car field?
Yeah, so I'm starting up a new group within Xcel that's really exclusively focused on helping our customers drive electric vehicles. So we're looking at all the policies required to make that happen, new programs to help customers, and things of that nature.
Okay, so just for the heck of it, tell us what are the advantages of an electric car over gas, diesel, or whatever else? And I'm saying, when I say cars, I guess I mean buses and mm-hmm. whatever, trucks, whatever, what's out there? I don't
right.
even know. What is out there?
Yeah, maybe I'll start there, and then
okay.
we'll talk about the benefits. So,
okay.
You know, I think certainly we think of, and what you know, you referenced the news. What we see in the news is usually those light duty vehicles that we drive to and from the grocery store to pick up the kids and things of that nature. And so I think we are seeing more and more models come out that are electric, and either they're fully electric, meaning there's no gasoline engine, or there's a hybrid and there's kind of a mix of powertrains. So that's primarily what we see out there today. I think the other market that you made reference to is transit buses. And a lot of experts think that market is actually going to convert to electric even faster
really?
Than vehicles.
Well, isn't it? Okay, go ahead. Finish. Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
Well, and I think you asked about the benefits. Like
yeah.
why?
Well, before you get to that, but right now, what is out there? Buses and trucks and.
Yeah, so right now, in the light-duty space, it really is primarily, the smaller sedans, certainly some sportier models are out there, some of what we might call crossovers and some of the small SUVs.
Mm-hmm.
And I think what we're seeing is to trend towards larger vehicles. And so there isn't yet, for example, a pickup truck that, might be widely
sure.
available. But I think people see that on the horizon because the models are getting bigger and faster and cheaper.
The, say a bus, I mean, are buses out there yet, electric buses out yet?
There are electric buses.
And I'm saying, I guess I mean, not city buses, they're too big, aren't they?
No, it actually is city buses. When
really?
I say transit buses, it is the, Metro Transit here and other transit agencies that are starting to pilot these buses, and a lot of folks see that as a really good application for this technology.
Certainly. Okay, so getting back to, what's the advantage of electric over gas diesel?
Right. And I think the long-term benefit is that it's going to be cheaper. And that's, I think, why there's so much excitement. And a lot of folks are investing a lot of money in this space, is this vision that as batteries become cheaper, these vehicles are going to be cheaper to buy. Already, they're cheaper to operate because of the difference between the price of a fuel like diesel or gasoline and the price of electricity. And then the other benefit is certainly environmental, in terms of, you know, there's less carbon emissions. Certainly the air quality within our cities is also critically important, and electric transportation can really help solve those problems.
Okay. How long has electric cars been out?
That's a good question. I think, you know, when you... you know, you'll see some examples of, you know, electric cars were some of the very first. And so there's some very, you know, examples from, you know, a very, very long time ago of electric vehicles. There's been a few attempts since then to bring them back. And I think what we now think of is kind of the current version of electric vehicles really came to the market in probably the 2011, 2012 timeframe.
Oh, really?
With Chevy Volt, Nissan Leaf, some of those vehicles.
So what is that now? That's total electric?
Total electric and some of the modern hybrids that we see out there.
The original ones, now I had a friend of mine who had one, and it just seemed to me, I mean this many years ago, one of the original, and I think it was hybrid, it might have been a hybrid, but the batteries in there were really large and very expensive to replace. I mean, well into the thousands of dollars. And I think that's why he got rid of it eventually, because he was afraid they'd have to put new batteries. So how far has that come along?
Oh, it's coming along very quickly. And I think that's why we're seeing the excitement. It really is, I mean, the battery technology is the critical component here in terms of cost and so forth. And so, you know, it's every couple of years where they're able to do a couple things. They both reduce the cost, but they're also making them more dense. So they're getting the same amount of power out of a smaller and smaller battery so that these vehicles can become more cost effective for all of us to buy and drive around.
Okay. So what is available now in terms of, I mean, I think we mentioned about buses. I'm thinking of, you know, like you see these Metro Mobility buses that go pick older people from their place and take them to shopping and that kind of thing. Buses like that, about that size, I guess, is what I'm thinking.
You know, there
are they available?
Yeah, there isn't a currently kind of a, what you might call an OEM vehicle that really fits that niche now.
Okay.
I think people do see that market being a future one that's addressed, but there really isn't probably a model that's really right for that right now.
Is a bus too big? I mean, to power, I mean, you put, say, a city bus, you put 50, 60, I don't know how many, 80 people on her, that's got to take a lot of...
It is, yeah. It's a big vehicle, and it requires a lot of power. And, you know, to give you a sense, the battery that goes into one of those big buses might be the equivalent of about 10 cars.
Oh, wow.
And so they really are able to find the space for those batteries and use them really effectively, too.
Sure. Okay, so I'm going to talk about the manufacturing end of it. What's in it for, well, who's doing the researching on electric cars? Is it Ford, GM, Chrysler? And if they are doing it, what do they get out of it? What's their advantage?
Right. Well, yeah, certainly when you talk about who's investing billions and billions of dollars in the vehicles, it's those companies you just named. Certainly you think of a company like Tesla as well when you think of electric cars these days. And, you know, I think, well, you know, in the near term, some of their reaction, some of their investment is due to environmental regulations. I think it's also due to, you know, a vision of the future that includes electric transportation. And whether that's driven by policy or environmental concerns or consumer desires, I think they all come together to create an environment where you know, they know they need to have electric drivetrains to be competitive in the future.
Car dealership or car manufacturers?
Car manufacturers, absolutely.
Competitive in what respect? I mean, to who?
Well, so I think probably the best example is not necessarily U.S. market, because I think you probably see us on the federal level stepping back from some of our environmental regulations. But you see certainly a market like China, which is quickly becoming, you know, it's a very fast-growing, very large market that is also electrifying at a very significant pace.
Here?
Absolutely. And so that's going to be the biggest market. And honestly, no matter what the U.S. chooses to do, no matter what we do in Minnesota and in our communities here, you know, these investments are being made because of, you know, markets like China, secondarily, you know, markets like Europe, where, you know, these technologies aren't just appreciated by consumers, but they're actually mandated by policy.
Sure. I'm thinking GM and Chrysler and Ford, they over the years, they've developed these engines and they're making them more efficient, and which they are. They're as good as they've ever been, and better transmissions and all that. But with an electric car, they don't need any of that, do they?
That's true. For a fully electric, those technologies are no longer required.
And that's, so that's got to be quite an advantage to them, isn't it? I mean, they don't have to put that much stuff in a car, do they?
Exactly, and I think that's, you know, when you if you come back to like what's the advantage of with these vehicles, the truth is they require very few moving pieces, very few moving parts,
yeah.
And so they're much faster to manufacture, easier to manufacture, and they're much less costly to maintain. And so I think we're still seeing, you know, these vehicles haven't been on the market all that long, but I think everybody's planning on these vehicles being, you know, very affordable for all of those reasons.
Wow. So at this point they have hybrids, correct? And that is gas and battery?
Right.
How does that work? How does it work?
Well, you know, a lot of manufacturers have taken a different approach, you know, slightly different approaches, but I think, as you said, it's largely a marriage between the two technologies, mm-hmm. and so you're not choosing one or the other, but you get both. And for a lot of vehicles, what it might look like is, you know, maybe your first 20, 30, 40, 50 miles are based on that battery, but if you want to go further, you'll have a gasoline engine that can take you further. And so the intent is to get, you know, the vast majority of your miles on the electric battery, mm-hmm. But make sure you've got the flexibility to get out of town when you need to and, you know, visit grandparents or whatever you like to do.
Mm-hmm. So are you people, Xcel Energy and other electric mm-hmm. companies, are you working with the design factor with GM and Ford and all that? Are you working together?
We do. It's certainly a new field for us, and it's a new field for them. So I wouldn't say we're working closely together, but we're starting to find projects in which we do pilots and talk about how, you know, their vehicles and our technology, our energy, can work together to really create a good, you know, a good customer experience. And so that's something that's still evolving over time. And I think, you know, that's certainly a big part of my job is making sure we develop those relationships so we can work more and more closely together.
You go to Detroit and work with those people, you personally?
You know, I would say that I don't spend too much time in Detroit. I spend a lot more time in California because increasingly that's where the electric vehicle world is kind of being centered. The automakers and a lot of others that develop this technology are increasingly convening in the California space because that's just such a large EV market.
They've always been leaders in the less gas and more efficient cars and that kind of thing, correct?
Correct, yeah.
So they're probably big time on electric.
They Perfect. Are, yes. More Perfect than half setup. The U.S. market.
Yeah. Okay. Now, all right, so show my ignorance here. I've never seen or been, I mean, I've seen them, I'm sure, but never been in an electric car in my life. Mm-hmm. I don't know what it looks like. What's inside, you know, batteries under the seats, plug-ins in the front, or describe one to me, will you?
Yeah, well, and better than that, sometime we've got to get you an electric vehicle. I'd love to do that. I think we could do that, make that happen sometime real
sure.
soon. And I think it is important to go out and look at it and feel it and even drive it yourself, because I think, you know, when I speak to electric vehicle owners and prospective buyers, that's a really pivotal moment when they actually sit in one and drive it around. It's hard for me to do justice to it, just describing it to you here. But, I mean, a couple of things that I draw out. I mean, the first is that it's hard to generalize, and that they are different. Some will have plugs in the side, some in the front, some in the back. Some will put batteries in different locations. But by and large, you know, the batteries are pretty low to the ground, so they help create a really low center of gravity. And that helps with the driving, and it creates what I think you hear universally from EV drivers is that it's fun. You know, there's an instant torque factor that you just don't get
really?
With a gasoline engine that
really?
Makes, you know, even some of these rather small cars accelerate in a way that's really fun. And so I think, you know, you'll hear a lot of people describe that driving experience in really positive terms.
Are they as big as a passenger, a gas passenger, four-door, that kind of thing?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think as I maybe referred to earlier, I think these vehicles are getting larger and larger, and, you know, we're seeing electric components into more of the mainstream vehicles you might buy. Mm-hmm. And so, yeah, what was once maybe reserved for the smaller vehicles, I think is becoming increasingly more of a mainstream vehicle that a family might consider.
So what's the price difference, you know, say an electric car, total mm-hmm. electric car, not a hybrid, mm-hmm. and a gas car? And I'm thinking, again, going back to GM putting in the cylinders and all the other stuff, but you don't need that in your car. So there should be a good price difference, correct?
There should, and there will, and I think it's changing a lot over time. And so today, there is certainly a premium for these vehicles. You know, it's still a very early stage for these battery electric vehicles. As you said, you know, the combustion engines that have been manufactured, those are getting to be very mature, and those are very efficient to produce and manufacture and so forth. So, you know, today there's a federal tax credit that covers about $7,500 for a buyer. Mm-hmm. But and even with that $7,500 tax credit, these vehicles are a little bit more expensive up front to buy.
Yeah.
And so, you know, really the value proposition and what might attract a customer is, you know, certainly the environmental benefits, but also the idea of saving money over time. Because instead of spending $2 or $3 a gallon for gas, you'll get to spend a dollar or maybe even 50 cents on electricity in a gasoline equivalent.
Okay, so plugging in, I mean, what do? You go home at night and you plug it in the outlet. Is it an outlet or is it a big honking thing or what is it?
Yeah, that's getting to exactly what our role is the electric utility, right? How do we help customers figure that out, answer that question, and go home and do just that to plug it in? And there are a couple of options, you know, and I guess I'd say first, you're kind of right to say you go home, because I think that is, you know, where the vast majority of charging is happening. It's right in your home, at your home, and that's what we want to see too. We want to help customers plug in at home in a way that's really cheap and easy, hopefully, very affordable for them to do. It's easier for some than others, though. You know, as you said, I think by and large, you know, you can plug these vehicles into a 110, 120 volt outlet. The difficulty is that might, you might get 30 or 40 miles, you know, depending on how long you leave your car parked overnight, which is maybe just barely enough for an average driver. And so I think increasingly we're expecting, you know, as these batteries get bigger, as customers use more and perhaps use larger vehicles, they're going to want flexibility and more high power, you know, higher powered charging available at their home. And so that's something they call level two charging, which is, you know, a special appliance that you get installed in your garage or wherever you park your car that provides, you know,
so again, more electricity going into that thing and then into your car faster, correct?
Exactly. So you can maybe charge your vehicle in just a couple of hours rather than overnight completely.
You know, Hy-Vee in Oakdale here has, and I didn't know what they were, they have these little whirly things, they're wind operated, I think they're generators or something, they're car plug-ins. Is that right?
Yeah, so I think what you're seeing a couple of things, but I think primarily at you know, places like Hy-Vee and others are starting to invest in some of this public charging or the charging that you see out and about, because sometimes it's not going to be enough to just park at home and you're, you know, where you live. You're going to want some more flexibility. And so we're going to see more and more charging out and about. Hy-Vee is an example of a company that's putting, you know, the infrastructure in place so you can do just that.
Sure. Is that whirly thing going and is that making electricity or generate? What does it do? I don't know.
Yeah, and I can't say for sure what that piece of equipment does, but I think what I'd remind people of is that usually that charging is really high powered. You know, for it to be a convenience for you and others, you know, you want a lot of power in a very short period of time. And so you're relying a lot on the grid to get that power. And so there's a role for that and a place for that, but it's pretty expensive to serve that, and that's why customers also have to pay a lot more for that as well.
Well, they have a windmill or something going on there. Does that generate electricity?
It might generate, but there's no way that would be generating enough necessarily to support that car. It's still going to have to be connected to the grid in order to make sure there's the throughput, all the power that you need whenever you pull up and want that charge.
Okay. So they must have it just for convenience that gives you a quick key just to get, so you can get home, okay?
Sure. Yeah.
Okay. All right, now, the obvious, of course, what's in it? What's all this electric cars and all that in it for? What's Xcel in it for? Is it obviously just to sell more electricity, which of course is going to happen, but what more does Xcel get out of this?
Yeah, I think, you know, in the long run, it's the ability to serve customers, you know, and we get to serve homes and buildings today, and that's fantastic. The notion of serving the transportation sector with electricity is really a fantastic opportunity. We see ourselves as clean energy leaders in a number of ways. And, you know, as we decarbonize and clean the electric power sector, we think putting that same power into our vehicles is going to create a lot of benefits. It's going to be cheaper. It's going to be cleaner, you know, for all of our customers. And to be part of that, to help them do that, you know, we think is going to be a tremendous thing for our customers and us in the long run.
Okay. In one of your brochures, it says something, and I'm going to throw 60% out. Eventually, like the year 2030, is going to be 60% electric vehicles. I mean, I'm not sure if that's correct, but are you going to be able to supply enough electricity for that? I mean, when if everybody's got an electric car, and then you start getting buses and commercial buses or trucks, then what?
Yeah, well, we are ready. And, you know, even the 2030 numbers, we serve a lot of power needs today, large factories, things of that nature. And so we're planning. You know, that's part of my group's responsibility is to help build those forecasts so that we have the power plants we need. We have the transmission systems, the distribution networks are being checked and things of that nature. So there will be some growing pains, but by and large, you know, that's our job as a utility, and we're ready to serve that load when it comes.
Good for you. Okay. So at this point, you're just mostly cars now, and then eventually you're going to get into bigger vehicles and that kind of thing, correct?
Yeah, I think we're going to be helping some of the transit agencies with the bus, but largely the mass market vehicles, and we'll be ready when other vehicles come to the market.
Okay. We're almost out of time. I just got one question left here. How are people reacting to this so far?
So far, it's still a small market. So that's, and I think you know that, right? This is less than 0.5% of new vehicles here in Minnesota are electric. But those people that are driving them, those people that are taking them for a test drive, absolutely love these vehicles. And that gives us all confidence that, this isn't something that's going to come and go. These vehicles, at the end of the day, they meet our needs increasingly. They can support larger, faster, more fun to drive vehicles. And so, I think that gives us all optimism that, this is something that can be a real positive for us.
Mm-hmm. I remember reading one place that one of the drawbacks of electric cars is that you can't hear them coming. and I'm half deaf anyway, and I keep thinking, I go down to get my mail and I'm daydreaming. I got to start looking because,
my vehicle actually has a special buzzer just for that,
really?
Just for that purpose, knowing that that's we need to make sure bicyclists, walkers, others, these new technologies do present challenges. And so, we need to be mindful of all that stuff.
Well, absolutely. Well, it's my own fault if I get run over because I'm not paying attention. Hey, Ever, good interview. You did a fine job, and we certainly learned a lot today. I did too, because I never did know. Right. And someday you take me out for a ride.
I would like that opportunity, Frank. Thanks so much. Yeah.
Kevin, thanks for coming. Enjoyed it.
Thank you.
It's time for a short break. During the break, we'll list some upcoming events taking place in the city of Oakdale. We'll be right back. That's all we have time for this month on Oakdale Update. For everyone at the City of Oakdale, thanks for watching.